Happy Sabbath, church family. I just want to thank Brother Lawrence for that beautiful, special music. Amen. Before I start this sermon, I just want to talk about several opportunities that we have here at the church. We already showed the video, BibleStudyOffer.com. This is a Bible school that we have started. And you'll notice a table in the foyer, in the middle of the foyer, of advertising materials for this Bible school. And if I just want to encourage you, before you go home, to take some materials and to share them with your friends, your family, your coworkers. We want to share with as many people as possible that we are offering Bible studies. The second thing is glow tracks. You'll notice a new set of glow tracks in the foyer. I encourage each of you to take some and pass them out to whoever, at the store, at the gas station, coworkers. It's very easy, just pass them out. Also, Amazing Facts Bible Studies. We have Bible studies that are available in the foyer, in the middle of the foyer. And if you have been praying for certain family members or certain friends, praying for them to have a spiritual interest, and they're asking you questions about the Bible, I encourage you, if you're in that situation, to take a packet of Bible studies and share it with them. And if that is the case, I would like to know about it, because we want to know who is interested in Bible studies. Amen?
Amen.
And the last thing is Go Team. We've already mentioned this a few weeks. Our Go Team is a team that goes out and delivers Bible studies and gives Bible studies. We're planning to do this as much as possible every Sabbath afternoon. And if you're interested in joining the Go Team, Elder Jimmy Holt, can you please raise your hand? Elder Jimmy Holt will be standing here on this side of the sanctuary in front of the organ. After the service, if you feel in your heart that you want to be on the Go Team to reach souls for the kingdom, please see Elder Jimmy Holt on this side of the sanctuary, and we will get your information. And those of you who are already on the Go Team, you know who you are. We're going to be meeting in the library at 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock. For some training and prayer. So I just want you to take note of that.
Amen.
There's a lot going on in the world today. Last Sunday night, we had the 59th Grammy Awards. Now, this is an award ceremony for famous musicians and artists that have made their name in this world. People like Beyonce, Adele. You know these names. I'm not going to mention them all. But this happened this past Sunday night. Many of these people, to people that listen to this music, they call them superstars. Superstars. But I want to submit to you that for us as Christians, the real superstar is Jesus. In Revelation chapter 22, verse 16, the Bible says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star. My friends, Jesus is your superstar. Let's pray. I will kneel and you will bow your heads. My Father in heaven, thank you so much for bringing us all here this morning to your house of worship. I pray that your Holy Spirit will be with me, not only to give me words, Father, but you would be in all of our hearts, that you would teach us what we need to learn this morning from your word. Father, I pray that your holy angels would shut us in this place, and that the devil and his angels will not be allowed here, Father. We don't want any distractions. Please shut us in at this time. And I pray that we would all gain a blessing this morning from being with you. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
If you have your Bibles or your iPads or whatever you're using this morning, hold them up. And say these words with me. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Do you believe it?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The sermon entitled this morning is Mirroring the Master. Mirroring the Master. I want to introduce to you my family. This is my mom and dad. This picture was taken a couple months ago. My mom is an immigrant from the Philippines, and my dad is an American. I was born and raised in an Adventist home by God's grace. At a very young age, my mom put me into violin and piano lessons. I was 3.5, 4 years old. So ever since I was young, music has been a huge part of my life. And by God's grace, I was taught the right principles of music and what was good and what was bad to listen to. But when I got into high school, this was a Christian high school, this was an Adventist, I had friends that were a huge influence on me. Not for good, but for wrong. And they started influencing me to listen to all types of music. And I started listening to more of this music, and it had a character change on me. Also, they knew that I played the violin, and so they also influenced me to go far, go beyond. Use music for my glory. To go as far as I can to become famous. And so when I was starting high school, I wanted to become famous. So I wanted to go to college and major in violin performance and become a performer for the rest of my life. And to glorify self in that way. My mom saw this. And she started praying that the Lord would take me out of this school. She wanted me to go to an Adventist boarding school. So she started praying that the Lord would lead her to a school that I could go to. Long story short, I was led to an Adventist boarding academy named Wachita Hills Academy. I struggled with this because the Lord brought this to my mom. And she said, if the Lord wants you to go to that school, I want the Holy Spirit to tell you that you should go also, not just me. I struggled with this because I didn't want to go there. And I already mentioned that I was into music. And I told my mom, look, they don't have a violin teacher. They don't have an orchestra. I had played in orchestras from a very young age. But I finally told the Lord, I said, if you really want me to go to this school, there has to be something there for me. And so I went, and on registration day, I found out from the staff that they had just hired a violin teacher, and that this violin teacher was going to start an orchestra. So God led me here, and He met those needs that I had for music. While I was at Wachita Hills Academy, I enlisted in the bell choir. Now, the conductor of the bell choir was a very spiritual mentor, and he taught us as students how to use music to glorify God and to reach others, and how not to use it to glorify self, because music is a talent that God has given us to share with others. And this had a big impact on me. And I was growing in my relationship with God being at this school. And I started learning these things. And I came to a verse in Matthew chapter 16, which I'm going to share with you a little later, that had a big impact on my life. And so I was learning these things, and my senior year, We went on a mission trip to Serbia and Europe. And I and one of my classmates preached an evangelistic series there. And that was the first time that I was involved in that type of ministry. And I saw the Holy Spirit working on the hearts of the people and giving their hearts to God. And that's the first time the Holy Spirit spoke to me, calling me to further ministry in my life. Amen. After high school, as I mentioned before, I wanted to first major in violin performance and go far with that and make a lot of money. But then because of the training that I received in academy, in Adventist Academy, it had changed from music violin performance to music education. I wanted to help young people and help others learn about music. And so that was the path that I was going to take. I wanted to take music education at Andrews University. So we went up to Andrews University, my parents and I, just to check out the school and the staff. And they said, this is going to take you 5 years to get this degree. And in my mind, I was like, 5 years? Jesus is coming soon. Why would I want to spend 5 years learning about music? And so, not only that, but other circumstances, God closed the door for me to go to Andrews University. And he opened the door. And I remember that call that I had gotten over in Europe to further God's work in ministry. And so I took that call and I decided to major in theology and in the ministerial work. So that's a little bit more about me. Before I continue, I want you all to imagine that you are a little kid again. And one morning you get out of bed and you find yourself looking straight into a mirror. Now at this point of life, you don't know what your purpose in life is quite yet. You don't know what high school you're going to go to. You don't know what college you're going to go to. You don't know who you're going to marry. And so you're asking yourself all these questions. What is my purpose in life? But the fact is, my friends, the truth is, if we are committed to God, He will direct our paths. And deep down inside our characters, when we look into that mirror, Jesus should be the one seen in front of you and not yourself. The point is, my friends, mirroring the Master means minding His mission. Mirroring the Master means minding His mission. What is specifically our mission here on earth? What do we need to do to be more like Christ? This morning, I want to share 3 specific points with you that deal with the mission that Christ gives us. And these 3 points come straight from the Bible. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. The Bible says, "Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works." This is what Christ did. Christ denied himself. Christ took up his cross, and Christ followed his Father. Christ was revealing his mission here to his disciples. You may ask me, why is Christ even saying these things here? Didn't the disciples know that they were supposed to be doing these things? Context will help us answer these questions. You see, Jesus and his disciples were walking through the region of Caesarea Philippi. This was a place where the disciples could be away from the influences of the scribes and the Pharisees. and they could see the influences of heathen worship. You see, there were superstitions all around them, and Jesus brought them here in order for his disciples to feel their need for the heathen. Jesus also wanted to reveal to them what was going to happen in the near future. He wanted to reveal to them about how he was going to be betrayed, how he was going to die on a cross, and how he was going to be raised the third day. But first, he was going to test their faith. Go back to Matthew 16, verse 13. Verse 13, the Bible says, "So he asked them this question," Matthew 16, "Whom do men say I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now the Holy Spirit rested upon the disciples in power, which gave them the faith to say who Christ really was. Peter was saying what the other disciples knew to be true, but they were still far from understanding the true mission of Jesus. Jesus then answers Peter in verse 17. "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto you, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus to show his disciples how he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not happen to you." If you know the history of the disciple Simon Peter, this is one time where he's not thinking before he's speaking. He's not thinking before he's speaking. Christ turned to Peter and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you savor not the things that be of God, but things that be of men." This was Satan's way of trying to discourage Jesus from his mission. By speaking through Peter, Satan wanted to tempt Jesus to discourage him from his mission. But once again, Christ fled temptation by rebuking Satan. Because Peter was tempted to say this, it shows that Peter did not know the true mission of Christ. He did not want what was going to happen to Christ, which was to be betrayed, die on the cross, and be raised the third day, to happen. This is why he was tempted to say this. I can imagine it was the same way with the other disciples. "No, I don't want this to happen to you, Lord. Why should this happen to you? Why do you have to die?" They didn't understand. The disciples as a whole did not understand Christ's mission and what they were supposed to do with it. This is why Christ continues to speak in verse 24, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works." In these few words, Christ describes how we are to be like Jesus. Amen. How we are to follow his example, and ultimately how we are to mirror himself. Amen. Mirroring the Master means minding his mission. In verse 24, Jesus mentions three ways that we can be like him, three ways that we can mind his mission. And these ways come straight from Scripture. The first way that we can be like Jesus is by denying self. Denying self. You might ask me, what does this mean? Let's look at verse 25. After Jesus mentions these three things, he explains them a little bit afterwards. Verse 25 says, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it." Let's focus on the first part of this verse. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. Christ is essentially saying here, whoever will save himself by his own power will not receive eternal life. This, you can say, is the unsuccessful means of obtaining salvation. Trying to gain salvation by our own power will not work. We cannot be saved without Christ. We cannot save ourselves by ourselves. We need Christ. And we can back this up with the Bible. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 says, "Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Here it is. "For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." Amen. You see, God puts me and you in the driver's seat, and he will not force us in any way. That leaves me and you to choose how we are going to act. It is possible for God to work in you by means of his own power and action in your life. As you yield up your will to him, as you invite him to do his work within you, the result is that your desires and your actions begin to harmonize with his. He will be able to transform your character to reflect his character. This will give you the desire to overcome self. Denying self means having Christ in you in order to be transformed into his character. To get a fuller means of what it means to deny self, let's look at the life of Christ. Christ's whole life was full of unselfishness. Christ was born in a little stinky stable. Christ honored his parents at a very young age. Christ went all over the area, teaching, preaching, healing, forgiving sins. Christ was unselfish. Amen. And all this, Christ shows his unselfishness by reaching out to people's needs. Christ said, "I have come to set the captives free." But to me, the ultimate unselfish thing that Christ did was to give up his divinity in order to become humanity that we all might be saved. Amen. Christ gave up his throne and his position and his authority to come to be an example to lonely, lost, sinful humanity. Is it possible for us to live a life like Christ did? A total life of unselfishness? With God's grace and his Holy Spirit, it is possible. One of my favorite authors says, "Love for souls for whom Christ died means crucifixion of self. He who is a child of God should henceforth look upon himself as a link in the chain let down to save the world. One with Christ and his plan of mercy, going forth with him to seek and save the lost. The Christian is ever to realize that he has consecrated himself to God, and that in character he is to reveal Christ to the world. The self-sacrifice, the sympathy, the love manifested in the life of Christ are to reappear in the life of the worker for God." And we are all workers for God. Amen. Another place, selfishness is death. I want to let that sink in for a second. Selfishness is death. No organ of the body could live should it confine its service of itself. The heart failing to send its life blood to the hand and the head would quickly lose its power. As our life blood, so is the love of Christ diffused through every part of his mystical body. Check this out. We are members one of another. We are the body of Christ, and we support each other in that way, right? We are members one of another, and the soul that refuses to impart will perish. We are to be servants. We are to be servants to our fellow brothers and sisters in love and respect. Amen. Showing unselfish love and respect to our fellow man and sharing what we have gained knowing Christ will allow us to deny ourselves. Amen. We also need to deny ourselves in a spiritual sense. In our Christian walk, we tend to sometimes do things ourselves that make others think we are good Christian. I'm a good Christian. I go to church. I pay my tithe, etc. This may lead us to have a prideful attitude. But we all need to go to Christ and ask him for humility of spirit. Amen. The book of James says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. And who shall lift you up? He, Christ, will lift you up. Not yourself, not yourself. Mirroring the master means minding his mission. Humbling ourselves is a very important way to be like Jesus and to mind his mission. But there are two more ways mentioned here in Matthew chapter 16 that help us to be more like Jesus. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will first come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. The second way is to take up your cross. What does this mean? Let's read verse 25 again. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Now let's focus on the second part of this verse. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. This verse says to me, whoever will set himself aside, and because of what Jesus has done for him on the cross, will receive eternal life. What has Christ done for all of us? He died for our sins. So it's because Jesus has died for our sins that enables us to humble ourselves. See, the first two points connect in that way. Allowing self to rule in the process of obtaining eternal life is the unsuccessful means of obtaining salvation. Allowing self to be set aside because of what Jesus has done for each of us on the cross is the successful means of obtaining salvation. How was the cross demonstrated in the life of Christ? You see, the cross was described like this. The cross was associated with the power of Rome. It was the instrument of the cruelest and most humiliating form of death. The lowest criminals were required to bear the cross to the place of execution. And often, as it was about to be laid on their shoulders, they resisted with desperate violence until they were overpowered and the instrument of torture was bound upon them. I want you to imagine with me what Christ went through. The cruel cross, well, first of all, he was whipped. The cruel cross was laid on his shoulders. Not only that, but he had a crown of thorns on his head, and he had to bear the cross to the place of Calvary. And he was nailed with his hands and with his feet. But we are told, when we read Scripture, we see that not one sound of pain came from his lips. All that comes from his mouth are the words that are spoken to the daughters of Jerusalem, not to weep for him. My friends, Jesus took that much pain. Jesus took that much suffering, and he died for you and me. Amen. This is how Christ literally took up that cross for us. Now, how can we apply this to our lives today? Jesus bade his followers take up the cross and bear it after him. To the disciples, his words, though dimly comprehended, pointed to their submission to the most bitter humiliation. Submission even unto the death for the sake of Christ. Now that doesn't sound easy. That to me sounds like a challenge, doesn't it? No more complete self-surrender could the Savior's words have pictured. But all this he had accepted for them. Jesus did not count heaven a place to be desired while we were lost. He left the heavenly courts for a life of reproach and insult and a death of shame. He who was rich in heaven's priceless treasure became poor, that through his poverty we might become rich. We as Christians are to follow the path that he trod for us. Taking up the cross of Jesus means that if we first humble ourselves, we will run into situations that we may not feel comfortable in. The truth is, my friends, as Christians, we are going to run into hard, difficult, trying situations as a follower of Jesus. But if we have to learn to stand for the cross of Christ in those situations and in every trial of life, no matter how great or small. Amen. Are we willing? Are we willing to go through that much pain in order to be like Jesus? I want to illustrate this point by looking carefully at the life of an ant. Ants are very interesting creatures. And when you look at an ant, you see that it goes along a path, and pretty soon its buddies follow in the exact same path. How do they know exactly where to go? Scientists have found out that they release a chemical substance from their abdomens as they go along this path. And the more and more ants that travel along this path, the more chemical substance is put down and the stronger this path gets. And sometimes this path gets wider and wider. Now, one scientist was looking at these ants in South America, and he saw one ant start in one spot and go around in a circle and end up in that same spot. Now, to you and me, that would sound like he's not accomplishing anything. But the chemical substance was laid down, and pretty soon more ants would follow in the same path. And the more ants would follow in this path, the stronger the circle would get and the wider the circle would get. And the scientists were looking at this picture of these ants, and they were doing this for such a long time that one by one, each of these ants started dying of exhaustion because they were going around this circle constantly. And you know what? This illustration of the ants shows me that they have a lot of loyalty to this path and the ants that they are following. This loyalty should be our loyalty to Christ. So you can imagine this large circle of ants going around and around, and they start dropping dead. And that is loyalty. And so the question is, are we as Christians willing to take up our crosses for Jesus and serve him to the death? Because these ants were dying because of this path that they were following. Mirroring the master means minding his mission. So what is the final way in which we can be like Jesus? Then Jesus said unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Amen. The third way is to follow Jesus. When Christ says, follow me, Christ is re-emphasizing what he has already said. If you want to follow me, you need to deny yourself and take up the cross. Following Jesus means I am doing these two things. However, my friends, this can't be just a once-in-a-lifetime occurrence type of event. Let's go to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, on verse 23. This is the same story as we are reading in Matthew, but there's a couple words here that is added that is not in Matthew. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. And he said unto them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. You see, my friends, this is not a once-in-a-lifetime type of an event. This needs to be a daily occurrence with me and you as Christians. It needs to become our lifestyle. Our lifestyle. Mirroring the life of Christ and beholding his life, we will be more like him. By beholding, we become changed into his image. Let's read verse 26 now. For what is a man profited, if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? What does Jesus mean when he says this? He is saying, you profit nothing by going and gaining the world. By chasing after the world, you lose your own soul. Again, this is a human tendency for us to secure salvation for ourselves. But there is nothing valuable in this world that you will lose your soul and your eternal life for it, not even yourself. Let's read verse 27. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. My friends, whatever decision you choose to make, you will get what you are striving for. Have you been trying to obtain salvation by yourself? Or have you allowed Jesus to do his work within you and are mirroring his life and his mission, doing what he was doing while he was here on this earth? It's a choice you and I have to make, because mirroring the Master means minding his mission. During the years leading up to the Civil War, our country was indulged in something called the slave trade. The slave trade. And there's a story of this young slave that was born in Africa. Now, at a very early young age, people could tell that this man was taller, bigger, and stronger than all the rest of his friends. And he was a prize to be taken. And when the slave traders came and picked him up, they took him back to the United States and they put all of his friends and him in an auction. And while this slave was standing there in chains, looking at all these people who were wanting to buy slaves, he thought in his mind, a lot of money, but I won't work. A lot of money, but I won't work. And soon, one by one, his friends were sold. And pretty soon, he was the only one left standing there, because I mentioned before, he was bigger, taller, and stronger than all the rest. And the prize that was going to be paid for him was going to be bigger than all the prize that was for his friends. And so finally, the auctioneer sold this big slave for an enormous price. Somebody was able to buy him. And as his new owner placed him in the carriage to go to his new home, he thought to himself, once again, a lot of money, but I won't work. A lot of money, but I won't work. He got so worked up that he even exclaimed out loud to his new master, a lot of money you paid for me, but I will not work. And his master humbly, in a good tone of voice, turns back to him and says, I did not buy you to make you work. I bought you to set you free. Amen. My friends, and he also said after that, Master, I will work for you for the rest of my life. Jesus has bought each and every one of us for a high price. He bought us to set us free. The question is, are we willing to work and follow him for the rest of our lives, faithfully doing the work that he has called us to do as Christians? Because mirroring the Master means minding his mission. Now let's go back to that mirror. How is Christ the one to be seen in that mirror and not you? My friends, the answer is here in the Bible. It is as you deny yourself. It is as you take up your cross and follow him daily that others will be able to see Christ in you. And so the result is that Jesus is the one standing in front of that mirror, because you have surrendered yourself to God and not yourself. See, in my life, I realized this. In high school, I realized that I was using music to my own benefit and not to God's benefit. And because of that, I realized that I was not minding his mission as I should. And so the Lord called me to take up his ministry and to work for him for the rest of my life? Do you feel his call this morning? This morning, are you willing to deny yourself? Are you willing to take up your cross? And are you willing to do this as a lifestyle and make Jesus the center of how you live? Are you willing to mirror the life of Christ by minding his mission? If you are willing to follow Jesus with your life and do these things, would you please stand with me? This morning, I would like to make a very special appeal. Maybe you are here for the first time. Maybe you have been coming to church and you've been hearing this message and you're saying, Lord, I have never surrendered my life to you fully. And if that is you, if you've never surrendered your whole life to Christ, this is the opportunity is now. If you have never surrendered your whole life to Christ, I invite you to come to the front and I will pray for you. This is a very special appeal. If you have never surrendered your life to Christ, I invite you to come to the front this morning. If you have never surrendered your life entirely to Christ, I invite you to come to the front. Amen, brother. Amen. Amen. Any others? If not, I'll have Pastor Santos give us a word of prayer this morning.
Loving Father, we thank you for speaking through us how we need to emulate the Master, how we need to mirror the Master, Jesus Christ. Jesus was a man of humility who humbled himself so that we may be brought to the foot of the cross. Dear Father, thank you so much for speaking to us. Help us take this message, apply it in our lives, leave this place realizing each day, Lord, we want to be more like Jesus. In everything that we do, in work, in prayer, in the way we live, in the way we play, we want to be like Jesus. Give us the character of Christ. Give us more of your spirit. Thank you, dear Father, for this young man that came forward to surrender all to you. Oh, Father in heaven, we need you to touch each one of us. Because sometimes we forget that our main goal and desire in life is to fully reflect the character of Christ. Thank you so much for hearing our prayers. This we pray, and everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.